And now on the line is Mamba Jabi, the director of the Africa Centre in Ireland, and Mamba is also the managing director of the Jabi Group. Mamba, welcome to the programme.
Thank you, Darren. Thank you for having me.
Okay, Mamba, I last spoke to you on radio around 3 years ago. Can you tell us what yous have been up to in the Africa Centre since then? And you can talk a bit about your group as well, the Jabi Group, if you want as well.
Yeah, the Africa Centre since 3 years ago has actually changed a lot. First of all, I think the organization has been affected by funding cuts. So at the moment, it's actually volunteer run, but in saying that, it doesn't mean that we are not having activities done. Since 3 years ago, we brought back the African Diaspora Development Forum, which is taking place every October, and there's one coming on soon. We had engaged in the voter mobilization for the local and the European elections that has happened this year. And then also our Intercultural Youth Society has kicked off. We have kind of a few diaspora young people engaged in looking at integration, their own political participation, and also we just completed a youth mobility project with our partner in Slovenia, where 34 youth workers has gathered in Slovenia in July, and 2 weeks ago we hosted them at Glen Prince Center for Peace and Reconciliation on monitoring evaluation. So as part of an EU-funded project, we also started something this year on mental health, which is funded by the Community Foundation, because mental health is affecting a lot of people within the African diaspora community, especially people who have been through the reception, the asylum process, people who have come here in their young, family unification. But because of the struggles they have gone through, we have also realized that some of those people have developed some mental health issues. So in that project, we are... it's in three stages, three activities actually in the project. First of all, we have a focus group discussion with African diaspora leaders, and there is a training program on mental health for them to understand how to deal with mental health in their communities. And also, we are going to produce materials. So finally, one of the things that we have started this year is our Africa program. We just set up an office in Gambia to look at migration and development. Because there's a lot of discussion around migration, especially in Europe. I think Europe really want to close the borders. But of course, we cannot do anything about migration, because probably it's the oldest profession that people found themselves. If we all want to go back to where we come from, then probably we have to all head to East Africa, everyone in this world, because I think that's the origin of everyone. So for that being the case, I don't think we can stop migration. So we just need to manage it. And also, people have this funny way of saying that illegal migration, there is no such thing like illegal migration. Migration has to be... either planned or unplanned migration. So you cannot have illegal migrants unless somebody is proven to be against the law. So it's either a regular or irregular migration. So for that indicates we just started a program there, and then I just completed a need assessment for the last 3 weeks in the Gambia. And then we are just starting to gather resources to kickstart that program. And part of that as well, I'm sitting on the African Union Commission Advisory Committee on Labour Migration as an African Centre representative. I used to be doing that myself as part of my diary group at a consultant, but because of that's a business, even though still I'm with the two, I decided to put the Africa Center there, which is going to be for the next 5 years to be on that committee. So that's where we are at the moment. So we are striving, and then things are beginning to improve. Like the last 6 months with the Africa Center is better than the whole of last year. And last year was better than the last 2 years, because, like, I don't know whether you remember, I actually left the Africa Center in 2015 to concentrate on my business. And since I left, the organization affected a lot. And then the board approached me to come back again and manage the organization. So 2018 was like a bit of a struggle. But like the first 6 months of 2019, it's far better than the whole of 2018 for us in terms of funding and activity. So we are actually improving a lot. And by the end of this year, I'm hoping that things will improve better. And next year, we'll have everything on track. And your second question in relation to the Javi group. Still going. It's not easy for startup companies. Like, experienced a lot of difficulties in terms of Javi Group, but I'm still there. It's still open. It's still doing consultancy and the training, and yeah. So that's where I am actually with the Javi Group at the moment.
Okay, to speak a bit about your campaign for the local European elections. There was an article in the Irish Times last month about a local election candidate. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing his name right, but Owen Natano, John Wukenpor or something. He's from Nigeria anyway. And did you see that article, did you?
Yeah, I think I saw something on John in Balbregan. Is that the article that you are talking about?
Yeah, in the Irish Times last month.
He stood for election in Balbregan, and then he did well. But I think, like, even the Africa Center, we did something that John participated. We actually had all the local election candidates in Balbregan, and then they have actually sign up to a 4-point pledge with us, and then so that has been something that John has participated, and then also we actually advocate for people to give votes for representatives of communities, not necessarily to say that don't give votes to other candidates, but this is something that we have actually advocated to get a representation. But I think the issue with the Balbregan area was that the candidates were too many, and especially for John, the unlucky thing was that at the end of the day, it was two people standing fighting for the same constituency. But John, I think he's a very active member of the Balbregan community because he's involved in the 30 towns. He's very active in doing a lot of work. He has a lot of concern about the community. I'm not saying that all of us don't have it, but because of me, I know John, and then we are engaged in so many things. He's also part of our Balbregan African community. It's a new network that we found, that myself and few other people, since I moved to Balbregan 4 years ago. It's called Balbregan African Community. So he's an active member in that. And hopefully in the next local elections, I think he might actually pull more than he did the last one.
Yeah, he said in that article, amongst other things, he said the Irish-born black teenagers in Ireland are having a, quote, identity crisis. What is the situation like on the ground, Mamba, for being a black man or black woman in Ireland today?
Like I think sometimes people they really exaggerate things. Like that's the situation for Balbriggan. Actually, when you go to Dublin, you hear a lot about Balbriggan, and then when you live in Balbriggan, you don't actually see that. But yes, I think he is right on that. Identity crisis is one thing, but also there are no services for young people in Balbriggan. Okay. None. There is no services for the young African people in Balbriggan. That's full stop.
Okay.
Because the thing is that you have youth clubs. These young people don't go to those youth clubs. Because, I think we have to be very, very, very clear to say to people that people need services according to sometimes maybe the way they are seen, the way they have their culture and things like that. And I think people working in these institutions still don't get it.
Okay.
These young people see the perpetrators of people who affect them similar to the people who works in this institution. Like, if you want these young people to go and work in these institutions, you need to be somebody there who knows where they are coming from. And that's the problem. That's the biggest problem in terms of integration in Ireland. I'm not going to say Irish people because we are all part of the society now. We are not learning anything. We are still doing the same thing that has happened in the early 2000s, getting people integrated by people who have no idea. Ireland has changed. We need to start employing people in these institutions that understand where these people are coming from and they can relate to them. But without doing that, zero. And it's not like people are not there who can get employed, but still employment within the African communities, especially the African diaspora community, is nearly 40%. When the country is at nearly 3 to 4%. So this is something that we need to look into. And then also we have to be very, very honest and say to the guys that the way they are dealing with these young people is actually disrespectful. And then also we have to really, really talk to the guys to actually change their way of treating these young people. That's what is happening around Balbriggan. That's what is happening around North County Dublin. The way the young people, there are videos circulated, there are incidents happening, and I'm pretty sure that there are cases before the law. I don't want to comment on those things against the Gardaí with the young people, but also the institutions. There's no proper playing ground. The youth club in Balbriggan is not accommodating these people. Even if there, they might say that those are open, but activities are not towards these people. There's no social amenities in Balbriggan. I know Balbriggan, there's a plan to improve Balbriggan, and then we are all engaged in that. Hopefully, when that is done, things will change. But there is zero amenities for young people in Balbriggan, and that's why. And sometimes one thing also that people need to understand is that as young people, when they are even on the street, because I go to this on the street, and when these young people are leaving, during lunch break or the close school coming, even the noise on the street is a bit threatening to other people. They are normal people, and it's normal in the society that they come from. When they are talking, they are young people, they could be loud, but that doesn't mean that they are threatening. And people see that they think that they are threatening, they are actually, they are rude, they are this. It's not. So you have to understand where these people are coming from. So people need to understand that. But also, I think one of the things that the messages I'm going to send home, where these young people are coming from, each and every family has a responsibility to talk to their people. Even though I have said that they don't have social amenities, people don't understand them, so they think they are over-exaggerated. There are certain incidences also which can be avoided. We need to talk to our young people about respect, about how to do their business. Because and then the parents also need to see to it that, look, Ireland is not like the Gambia, it's not like Sierra Leone, it's not like Nigeria, it's not like Congo, it's not like Morocco or Algeria or Tunisia. Ireland is totally different. We need to actually embrace that as well and talk to our children about how things work. Either the children themselves or even parents themselves, we need to actually integrate ourselves. Nobody will do that. There is no book to say like how to live in Ireland, a classroom that you can go and have lessons how to live in Ireland or how to live in society. But this is something that I think we need to have a constant discussion within our community, our families, to say that how things happen. We need to start talking to each other and commit this thing to talk to each other. Whether it's an African community or Irish community, we need to have that conversation. And the authorities, especially the guards, need to be in that conversation because they need to understand where people are coming from. So, and if we do that, we can avoid problems. So that's what is happening in Balbriggan. And it's not different to what is happening in Blanchetown, in other places. But Balbriggan, the issue in Balbriggan is we have a lot of young people, lots of them from migrant background, not only African, migrant background, and they have no social amenities. There is no support for them. So that's the problem. If young people don't have support, they will go on the street. They will meet their peers. They are lousy, which means that they are threatening. So this is what people don't understand.
It's the same or similar in Terrestown as well, isn't it?
Yeah, in Terrestown is the same thing. Like when people, like I think Ireland need to wake up. Like you, people are coming. We cannot stop people. This is what I said about migration. Migration will always happen, whether people like. Yeah, no. I what I was saying is that like the
Terrestown.
Yeah, Terrestown also. The integration process, we Ireland embrace people, not now. Like, the people came to Ireland when there were shortages of work. And some people came here because they were looking for sanctuaries, like asylum seekers, and they become refugees. Ireland brought program refugees as well. So I think this is the responsibility of the government also to explain to people that some of the people are here because they brought them. You see, like, and then these people need to know that, look, we all brought people here because, first of all, we are sorted of work, and also we offer sanctuaries of people we pick from other refugee camps and we gave them refugee status. We need to be very clear about this. And even the people who came here as an asylum seekers and refugees, like, we collectively as a nation accepted them. So this should be very, very clear to people. And the second thing also is that we should be ready to invest on the integration of these people. People will integrate themselves because like, I don't think it's the responsibility of the government or other institutions or NGOs who have no cultural background to say that they are going to be responsible. So the government also needs to provide support financially to these people, like to support themselves. And then I've been saying this, and people have said, okay, you are campaigning for Africa. But of course, yes, because we know where these people are coming from, that other services provided to them. Yeah, at the time, they were doing great because they don't have, it was small numbers. People don't also know enough about Ireland. But like these people, people in these communities, like the African diaspora have been here for a while now, and they know. So they should be able to help the people who are coming in newly, or people who are facing challenges, then actually depending on bringing like other people who have no cultural background or don't know where these people are coming from to still plan programs for them. We need to stop that. I think we need to actually be more inclusive. We need to give support to people, and we need to be responsible to say that, yeah, these are our people again, because nobody is going anywhere. Most of the people are regularized, they are citizens, they don't get jobs. They are citizens, they are sick. They are citizens, they are homeless. They are citizens, they don't actually get support from, like, in terms of healthcare. So what do we need? What do we do for them? Is that we need to be inclusive. We need to actually stand back and say, look, we need to support these people to integrate. And then that means we have to provide services for them. So that's the problem. If we don't do that, well, it's going to be a problem in the future. And in order to avoid that, we need to start talking now and be very sincere to ourselves and say, yeah, this is what we need to do.
Okay. Okay, ma'am, we leave it there, or do you want to say anything else?
Yeah, no, you mentioned about the continent. Like, I think it'll be good to see what is happening with the IFTA agreement between African countries in terms of trade liberalization between countries. And also what is happening on the ground is that like the African monetary, especially West African, they are talking about the monetary union and then the African passport. So I think your listeners also need to hear a bit about what is happening on the continent of Africa. And then because it also linked to migration, even though Africans are coming to Ireland, and the African continent is also doing something for itself, because that's one thing people don't normally hear. Because the information in Ireland about Africans has been through the NGOs, especially local NGOs working on integration, international NGOs delivering services to African countries, which I could say that it benefits more than the services they are providing, because that's where they are. The international staff, the expatriates are paid, and that money is coming back here. We comprise over 40% of that money is actually turning back to the countries where those monies are coming from, including Ireland. So the money we are giving to international NGOs, most of it is actually coming back here. So we need to know that. But on the continent, there's a lot of trade agreement. There's a lot of discussion about made in Africa in terms of manufacturing. There's a lot of movement in terms of producing things made in Africa to be sold to the wider Europe. Value added is one thing that's discussed. There's a lot of young people in fintech, like the financial technology, in terms of banking, because mobile money is actually happening in most countries. It's recently just coming to Ireland and the European country, but if you look at M-Pesa in Kenya and other places, people have developed so many applications. The ICT is booming. Some countries are actually talking about the 5G at the moment, the 4G is already in operation. So there's a lot happening. The capital gains in countries like economic recovery is coming. People are collecting more taxes. So like countries are actually doing a lot. People are investing a lot on agriculture to make sure there's a food sufficiency. And migration discussion is happening every now and then. I sit on the committee at the African Union Commission, so we are looking into what are the deterrent factors that the countries can actually implement in terms of job creation, to make sure that people are not taking these crazy routes towards Europe and other places as well. So I think there's a lot happening. So and then that's something good news for people to hear as well. So Africa is open as always in terms of trade, and then investment is something that anyone who your listeners want to actually see what are the opportunities in any African countries. They can talk to myself, come to the Africa Center, but also there is a lot of Africans here in Ireland who are actually doing trade promotion as well. So there's a lot happening, and then things are moving very fast, very, very fast, because the fastest growing economies are on the continent. So that's where things are happening at the moment.
And I was reading, remember, recently that one of the things that's planned over the next few years with the African Union is it's going to be a pan-African currency similar to the euro in the EU, you know. I think this is a great idea, isn't it? What do you think of it?
It's a great idea, but I think that will have a lot of discussions, because it would be... even though it's a noble idea, and I think everyone is welcoming that, but it has its own challenges as well. I know about the West African one, which they have already agreed. I think it's 20 in the next 2 years they will have something. But the problem there is that within Africa, you have to understand that some of the currencies are printed still by the colonial masters, so to say, like France. For example, if you look at the Francophone Africa countries, they use CFA. The CFA is actually printed in France, and that's a very contagious debate at the moment, because they don't have their central banks. Like, for example, Senegal, our close neighbor to the Gambia, money is printed in France, and then their reserves are in the Central Bank of Paris, in France, sorry, Central Bank of France. So that's a problem. And then, so you see, like, that's a challenge for France itself, because like all these people are putting their money into the French Central Bank. So if they have to have a unified currency, that means it has to be a central bank, like from the African Central Bank or ECOWAS, which are actually the part of having their own money. So, the economy is going to be bankrupt, because that's one of the things people don't actually know about, how France is still colonizing countries, Francophone. In West Africa, it's only Mali, because that was used to the time he actually decided not to go with that. But all the others, they have their central bank. So it's going to be it's a cool idea. I think people will comment, but it's going to be really tough. But West African countries, ECOWAS has already agreed that they are going to have something called ECO in the next 3 years.
Mm.
And in fact, France was against it, and then some of the Francophone countries, especially Ivory Coast, probably one way or the other, the Maltese or France. But then at the last parties also agree as well. So West Africa has agreed ECOWAS to have ECO as soon as possible. And then the French-speaking countries like Senegal, Ivory Coast, I think Mauritania, and others would have adopted that money. So they wouldn't rely on France to pay that money for them as well. So, yeah, I think it's something, it's a way forward, and everyone is. It's just like the EFTA, the common trade agreement between African countries. So everyone is looking forward to having the currency, whereby it actually also signifies the independence of these countries to actually broke some relationship with their colonial masters at some point, to be more independent in terms of finance and then industrial trade. So which is good.
Okay, Mama. I'll come back to you again, and we'll talk about it again anyway, okay?
Yeah, no worries. Thanks.
Okay, thanks, Mama. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.